Hello, Professor Ian. Welcome to ITC and welcome to the GeoHero channel.
Thank you.
What are we going to talk about today?
Today, I'm going to talk about science communication, but with a twist, because I'm a geologist, an earth scientist. So all my work is about how do we communicate, not to the planet, but about the planet to people. You know, how do we make them care about the earth, its history, and more importantly, perhaps, what it means for us in the future. What can I tell you about science communication? Well, that it's hard, that it's fun. Maybe I should have switched that around. It's fun, number one, and it's hard. I think the thing that interests me is why are other people interested in science communication? I think there's a tendency amongst particular academics to, I think, I know about my subject and everyone else should, you know, and that the public really, their heads are empty of this critical information that I need to jam into their heads. And I guess when I started, I was thinking that. Now I'm a little bit more interested in the flip side. What are people interested in? What are their concerns? What are they worried about? What do they want to talk about? And then try to bend my knowledge or my geoscience knowledge to those kind of issues. And that relates to things like contentious issues, climate change, where we're going to get energy from, mining, this kind of thing, or complicated stuff like how do you prepare people for disaster risk, etc.
Okay. Well, you mentioned the climate change crisis, and this is something that has a lot of, there are a lot of people who don't believe that or think that this is a hoax. Mm. And this is one of the things that we try to fight with communication.
Yeah.
What can you say about that?
Yeah, I mean, the climate skepticism or downright denial has been a really big and important thing. I think it's less now. I think the science has got better. And so those people have either converted to the bright side, the white side, if you like, or in some cases gone into a slightly different space. There's a group now that are kind of climate deniers that have gone into the doomsday group that say it's so happening that it's too late. And that, you know, nothing we can do can affect it. So why are we spending all this money on something we can't change? Let's just kind of have a good time, kind of thing. But it still is a recipe for inaction. So that's it's mm-hmm. just as bad as saying it's not happening yep. at all. So I think that one of the things, most people are in the middle, messy middle, you know. They maybe don't know the science, but they kind of know what's happening. They broadly trust the scientists and the scientific process. But they don't know what to do about it, and they don't know what to do at scale. And you know, they know that recycling or switching the lights off is not going to affect these critical issues, but they feel disempowered. So I think a lot of communication now is about how to motivate people, to give them a sense of self-efficacy, that they can do something about it, or that by changing the public's view, that'll then impinge and affect the, say, business leaders and politicians. And that's where a lot of the traction for change can come. And so we're seeing communication played out in lots of different places and lots of different ways in the climate change arena.
And, well, a follow-up on that is that right now we have a big problem with the media being also polarized, and that the trust in the media has become less and less. How do we play a role in that, in the science?
The problem of trust is critical in communication. You know, when people are interested and want to know about something, they turn to people they can trust. They'll turn to their friends, they'll turn to their family, the media people, not necessarily experts, but they'll just want to know with some kind of confidence that the decisions they're making are the right ones. And many people don't know a scientist. They're a completely different breed, an alien species that lives somewhere else. You know? So I think that one of the problems we've created, I think, for ourselves is there's a disconnect between scientists and the public. So one of the things is just creating these interconnectives again so that people can engage more with scientists. And we've seen this played out big with the COVID thing about the role of scientists in the media and how they relate to the public. And that's put a more of a focus on back into the climate regime, which is, you know, how can scientists engage more creatively and authentically with the public so that they are seen as trusted brokers of information. And that needs change on the academic side. That's not just a case of some professor turning up and saying, I'm a professor of climate science, believe me. Mm-hmm. That's about the way we train our young scientists and early career scientists and mid-career scientists to see the public not as the problem, but as the solution. That is, they're a big resource, and if you can engage with them and motivate them, then they become this force for, this catalyst for transformation, rather than a barrier to, you know, getting policy change. So I think it's going to, there's no easy answer for this. It's mm-hmm. going to take enduring engagement, creative ways to connect with each other, and time. And unfortunately, time is what we don't have. So the paradox is we have to do this really fast and at scale, but at the same time, we need to develop more gradually these trusted relations. So it is tricky, that balancing act.
Yeah. One of the things that is happening here at the University of Twente is that there's a whole effort to bring the community inside the university. So bring them right. into the campus
yeah.
and show to them what we are doing.
Yeah, that sounds great. I mean, that sort of democratizing of science, of opening science up is really critical. And it's not a criticism of that, but one of the factors is usually the people who come in are already the people who are very pro-science. You know, they're already kind of, if we're talking about climate change, accept climate change and want to do something about it. So sometimes you need measures beyond that to do the opposite, to take the scientists into the public spaces where the people are. You know, where would that be? Would that be schools? Would that be pubs? You know, bars? Would that be libraries? We need to get out, as well as bringing people in and demystifying science, I think is a really important bit.
Okay. What is your personal experience? What did you get back from communicating science personally?
So I think, you know, there's a performer, and I give lots of talks and as I say, as well as making television programs, and there's a kind of media performance thing that you like, and the same thing as being on stage and all that. So giving a talk and get then the Q&A, it enlivens you from that. I think just generally though, you know, we as an academic, you're encouraged to write these academic papers and that your career projection really follows that rather abstract path. And so public engagement, science communication is an antidote to the marginality, the isolation of that academic exercise. You see people and, you know, often you see them in the eye, you're reacting to them. It's a very tangible engagement. And so it's fun. You come away feeling you've done something worthwhile, even if it doesn't matter who you've talked to, you know. So it's a very personal thing for me. I mean, I could set it in aspirational goals and big strategic goals, but I do it because I enjoy it and it's fun.
Okay, and where we stand now, if you were to look at a graph, are we at near 0% or 100% in terms of reaching everybody or reaching the all communities and all the people?
It's tricky, that question, because one of the things, I do a lot of things for the public, you know, which is, I guess, that 100%. But even then, you know, my programs reach a particular subset of the public. They go out on the second channel, BBC Two, the second BBC Two channel. So that's already a smaller audience. And then they reach people who like science, so you shorten it even more. But the reality is that you start to realize you don't need to reach everyone. And anyone who's worked in communication knows it's, you really need to think of who you're trying to reach, who's your audience. And sometimes your audience for some of these issues is actually quite a small group of people. It might be decision makers of a particular type in a municipality, or it might be people working in education curriculum evolution, or it might be a community that's sitting in a risky place. So thankfully, you don't have to do the 100% of the audience. You can be thinking, now then the question is, of the subset you need to reach, how much have you reached them? And then I think that's a place where it is difficult, because we do lots of science communication. We're not brilliant at evaluating it and saying, have we been effective? What was setting up beforehand? What would success look like? And did we match that? So I think we need to get better at applying the science of communication to the challenges we've got, and then you know, measuring the extent to which we're actually doing that, and then maybe rethink things and change it around, experiment a bit. So that's why I think it's such an exciting field, is that it's not just a case of, you know, you do one, two, three, and that's, you get it. This is a research field. You know, it's a really a platform for interaction and engagement where you're constantly learning, constantly evolving.
All right. Thank you very much for this talk.
Thank you.
I hope to see you again.
Yeah, no, thank you.
Do you want to be a GeoHero as well? Then take the first step and click the subscribe button and then the bell button to always be the first to know when one of our GeoHeroes posts a new video.